good morning for those of you joining from the US, and good afternoon if you're from somewhere else, and good evening if you're in China. So by way of introduction, my name is Devin Lau. I am the Assistant Director for Yale Center Beijing. For those of you guys that are unfamiliar, Yale Center Beijing has been around since 2014 as Yale University's first and only university-wide center outside of New Haven. And of course, during the pandemic, we've transitioned to, as everybody else has, to Zoom activities online. So now we're a year and a half, almost 2 years now of Zoom activities. Hopefully we can end that soon and have some professors visiting China soon. But we've been lucky enough to have be the host of many professors from a wide variety of subjects, including, as you saw in some of our previous videos, astronomy and music and drama, a lot of history and philosophy and economics as well, and of course the hard sciences. And so our goal is to bring the best of Yale to our audience in China, and through the magic of Zoom, now basically a global audience. And so that's, I think, very appropriate for today's topic, which is talking about the Bay of Bengal, which has historically been a rather international port of exchange, or place of exchange. And so we're lucky to have Professor Sunil Amrith. Let me introduce him real quick and then turn my time over to him. Professor Sunil Amrith is the Renu and Anand Dhawan Professor of History at Yale. He received his post-secondary education at the University of Cambridge, as well as he was the inaugural Mira Family Professor of South Asian History at Harvard, starting in 2015. His research focuses on modern South Asia, Southeast Asia, as well as Indian Ocean history. And he's actually since expanded to basically cover exchange of ideas and people and what have you all around the world. He was named a MacArthur Fellow in 2017, as well as was awarded the Infosys Prize in Humanities for his contributions to the field of history in, as I mentioned, migration, environmental history, and the history of international public health, and of course, contemporary Asia. And so we're very lucky to have him here today. I myself was a history major at Yale, so I'm very excited to be able to engage with Professor Amrith on this topic of the Bay of Bengal in history. And also today we are very lucky to have Zhejiang People's Publishing House, which is the Chinese publisher of the Chinese translation of Professor Amrith's book. They have offered to give the first five participants in our discussion a free copy of the book in Chinese. And so get your questions ready. I will say though that they should be good quality questions and not just random questions. And I will make sure, I guess I will be the arbiter of that. So anyway, without further ado, here is Professor Amrith. He will talk for about 10 minutes, 10 to 15 minutes, and then we'll open it up for discussion.
Thank you, Devin. Thank you so much for having me. I'm really pleased to be here with all of you. I hope one day to visit Yale Center Beijing in person, but for now it's really nice to be able to connect across distance. So I've only been at Yale for a year. As Devin mentioned, I moved here from Harvard last June, right in the middle of the pandemic. And I'd be very happy to talk not only about my book and my work, but also the kind of work that we're doing at Yale on Asian studies, Asian history. I feel one of the reasons I chose to come here from Harvard was I felt like Yale was a very dynamic place to study the connections between Asian societies, and that has proven very much the case. We have some very lively programming, hopefully once again on campus coming from this fall. Wonderful graduate students from China, from Southeast Asia, from India, who are doing incredible work. And it's a privilege to work with them. I'd be very happy to talk to all of you about the kind of plans we have here on campus. One of my roles at Yale is I'm chair of the South Asian Studies Council. But I work very closely with my counterparts in East Asian studies and in Southeast Asian studies. And one of our goals is actually to think beyond some of those boundaries in the way that we both teach and study Asia and Asian history and Asian contemporary societies. And I feel like this is a promising moment to be able to do that. So that is a transition to my own work. And one of the key things in all of the work that I have done has been to try to, in my case, particularly think about the links between India and Southeast Asia. Because in academic scholarship, especially in the West, I would say, there's been a tradition to really divide Asia into South Asia, Southeast Asia, East Asia. And these develop quite separately from one another, certainly in the 1960s and 70s, through most of the 20th century. Not a lot of dialogue across these different what we call area studies. And I think that's really started to change over the last 10 or 15 years. And one reason that's changed is because the world is changing, because we can see so many new kinds of connections between Asian societies in ways that mean I think it's more important than ever to understand some of the history of their connections. So since the beginning of the last decade, maybe the 2000s, we've heard a lot about the Indian Ocean, or maybe sometimes it's called the Indo-Pacific, as a very important new arena, economically, geopolitically, environmentally. And what led me to write this book, Crossing the Bay of Bengal, which I'm delighted has just been translated into Chinese, what led me to write it was I wanted to make the point that this is not the emergence of a region, it is the re-emergence of a region. And what I wanted to point out was that this Indian Ocean region has a very, very long history of being a connected space. And these connections stretch all the way from China in the East to the Middle East in the West. This was a very, very deeply intercultural, multi-religious, multilinguistic space. And it was that long before the Europeans came to Asia. It was already a very, if you like, a globalized space, a place of intensive trading connections, where very important port cities, again, all the way from Guangzhou to Basra in what is now Iraq, were connected with one another through many, many, many short trading journeys that crossed the entire Indian Ocean, going back 1,000 years or more than that, much more than that. So my question was, how do we understand how this region has changed over time? That in some periods of history, it has been very connected. In other periods, it has not been very connected. So the low point of connection in the Indian Ocean was actually the second half of the 20th century. From the 1950s to maybe the 1990s or the early 2000s, connections across the Indian Ocean region were at a low point. Historically at a low point. And one of my questions is, how do we explain, first of all, how those connections faded away, and then how they have reemerged? So what are the long-term patterns that we can see in the development of this area? And in this book, Crossing the Bay of Bengal, I wanted to highlight two key themes. One was migration. And my argument was that the eastern part of the Indian Ocean, which we call the Bay of Bengal, was one of the most intensive spaces of human movement in the world. That in global historical terms, especially in the 19th century, the Bay of Bengal region sees one of the largest migrations of people in human history. And one of the things that always surprises my American colleagues is when I tell them that the same number of people cross the Bay of Bengal as cross the Atlantic. And of course, here in the US, the transatlantic migration is such an important part of one's understanding of America and American history. And that is seen as, you know, if you like, the classic migration. Just as many people were moving from India and also from China to Southeast Asia at the same time. And so I think one of my interventions here was to take a more global perspective of migration history and to understand that Asia, particularly Southeast Asia, which is like the crossroads between East Asia and South Asia, is really at the heart of that story. And this is just to give you an example of this is taken from the shipping map of from around 1900. And you can see just how closely connected these ports are. On one estimate, something like 29 million passenger journeys were sort of connecting these ports from the 1870s until the 1930s. So this is a place of a vast migration. The other point I wanted to make was what I started with, the idea that if we think about South Asia and Southeast Asia as completely distinct, then we miss this story. My starting point was in South India, which is the part of India that I have studied most intensively. And the whole of this book, the whole of this project began with something like a thought experiment. And my thought was, what if we thought of South India as part of Southeast Asia, as much as it is part of India? Because that is really historically what it was, that for many people, particularly in these coastal towns, from Madras, what is now Chennai, all the way down to the southern coast, their mental map, their family connections, their opportunities, they were more likely to be across the sea in Southeast Asia than in any other part of India. It's only after Indian independence in the 1940s that that sort of reorients inwards. So if you took a census in 1900, even in 1920, there would be more people from this part of South India. There'd be more people from South India living in Singapore, in Rangoon, in Penang, than in any other Indian city. More than you had in Bombay, more than you had in Delhi. They were going across to Southeast Asia. And what struck me was that we've completely lost the ability to see that world because we are so accustomed, of course, to the idea that South India is primarily connected to India and much less so with Southeast Asia. So my argument is that the further back you go in history, the more these kinds of puzzles emerge. And I feel that remembering this can help us to understand why this region reemerges in the 2000s as such an important space of not just economic, but also cultural connections. The other main theme in this work was environmental history. Environmental history is a major growth area in my discipline for obvious reasons. I think a lot of us are interested in some of the historical context for the environmental crises that we face. So we're interested in charting the origins of some of the choices that were made that have now left many people very vulnerable to rising sea levels and storm surges and many other kinds of problems. So the last part of this book, Crossing the Bay of Bengal, took me into this question of environmental history and how actually climate is one of the connecting factors in the Indian Ocean, that there is a shared vulnerability to cyclones or typhoons by the time you get into the South China Sea, that there is the opportunity to share knowledge and to share expertise when it comes to environmental challenges. So just to sort of take the story forward a little bit, I published this book in English about 8 years ago, though it's just been translated into Chinese. After that, I went on to write a book called Unruly Waters, which came out just a couple of years ago. Happily, that's also going to be translated into Chinese in the next year or two. And this takes forward that environmental history story. And it argues, really picking up from the end of Crossing the Bay of Bengal, that one of the key connecting factors across this entire region is actually the monsoon, is the climatic patterns that have made various kinds of economic and trading connections possible going back hundreds of years, but which, you know, the 20th century and certainly in our own century also pose new kinds of risks and really demand new forms of cooperation. It's very interesting to me that in China, I was initially surprised that there was interest to translate this work. And then I came to realize from an increasing number of academic interactions I've had with China that China's really become a really major center for the study of the Indian Ocean. And there is in Shenzhen, there is a center for Bay of Bengal studies. There's no such center in all of India. So it's very interesting that there is a sort of recognition and an interest in this part of the world, in China, also in Korea, certainly in places like Singapore, which I feel like there's a sort of new kind of knowledge that's being produced within the region about these interconnections and about this region. But I did find it very interesting that there's a Center for Bay of Bengal Studies in Shenzhen and nowhere in India. So I think this is, you know, in some ways, you could almost argue that India has been the last to recognize these histories and these connections across the Indian Ocean. I think that's starting to change now as well. So in the last couple of minutes, and I'm really happy to talk about any aspect of this work, just want to say a little bit about what we're doing at Yale, which is that not only do we have our regional studies councils, we also have an Inter-Asia initiative, which is directed by my colleagues in anthropology, Professors Helen Hsu and K. Shivaramakrishnan. And the Inter-Asia initiative is all about trying to join up these dots, is trying to share expertise across these different area studies. And I work very closely with my colleague, Professor Eric Harms, who's head of the Southeast Asian Studies Council. One of our common interests, for example, is in Myanmar. I'm thinking, what can Yale do to promote peace in Myanmar in very troubled times there? Because Myanmar is a classic example of one of those countries which it was ruled by the British as part of India. But now we think of it as very much part of Southeast Asia, not as South Asia. It's a classic case of a country that's at the boundary of those regional studies. And sometimes, in fact, I would say that Myanmar has been really ignored by scholars, at least in the West, partly because it falls across those boundaries. So one of the things we're trying to do is to pay attention to places like Myanmar, which maybe are very much at the crossroads between South Asia and Southeast Asia. There was a book about Myanmar written by Thant Minh Thieu, who is a historian, also a major political figure in the region, who wrote, he called his book Where India and China Meet. And that was his sort of take on Myanmar as a place which is strategically and economically important precisely because it is a meeting point, as it also was historically between not just India and China as nations, but also between Indian and Chinese diasporas and migrants. And one of the key themes in my work is actually that if we think about the long history of both the Indian and Chinese diasporas and their meetings, their meeting points were mostly in Southeast Asia, places like Malaysia, Myanmar, even Indonesia, to some extent, even Vietnam. There are ways in which we can understand the interactions between Indian and Chinese societies, not just if we're thinking about the level of international relations and state-to-state relations, but very much a kind of people-to-people relations that happens because both of these countries have such large and extensive diasporas and migrants going back hundreds of years that very often shared space and came to all sorts of cultural interactions in the port cities of Southeast Asia. So these are some of the big themes of my work and also my teaching here at Yale, thinking about migration, thinking about environmental history, but also thinking about regions in a slightly different way, thinking about how we can cross some of those barriers between the study of East Asia, Southeast Asia, and South Asia in ways that I think are more important than ever. I think if we want to understand many of the key challenges facing Asia today, environmental challenges, geopolitical challenges, we need to think big, and we need to be able to think across some of those boundaries that I think have often limited our vision and limited our understanding over the past several decades. So I'll stop my presentation part there, but very happy, as I say, to pick up on anything really that you would all like to talk about. Thank you.
Great, thanks so much. And so now we're gonna transition into time of Q&A. So anybody that has any questions, as Professor Amrith mentioned about his book, about his other fields of interest, as well as just the study of Asia as a whole at Yale, please feel free to ask. And once again, the first five people to ask a question, Zhejiang People's Publishing House has graciously agreed to send a copy of Professor Amrith's Chinese translated book to them. So I see we have Jewel in the chat box. So during the COVID pandemic, we can see that people worldwide manage the issue in very different ways. From your perspective, how do cultures influence people's behavior to handle COVID? And how could we leverage the power of culture to solve public health issues?
That's a great question. Funnily enough, it takes me back to my first book, which I haven't talked about here. And in fact, that was a history of international public health in South and Southeast Asia. And this goes back to my doctoral work. So it was very, very, very long time ago. But this is a great question because I think COVID is a you know, if ever a historian or a political scientist wanted a kind of natural experiment to show how much culture and political culture matters, you only need to look at how neighboring countries across the world have dealt with this pandemic. Just take one very clear example, which I've just been reading about, Sweden and Norway. We think of Sweden and Norway as having a lot in common culturally. They took diametrically opposite approaches to the pandemic. Sweden, probably at sort of one extreme in the world, decided to do very little. The Swedish state decided, we're not going to do too much. Norway took a much more careful, cautious approach. And I think you see the same thing across the world, that countries that may seem to be quite close together have opted for very different paths in this. And so I think culture can help to explain it, but probably even more than that is that sort of relationship between culture and politics, or culture and the particular political choices that any society wants to make. And I think we can see, societies across Asia, even just to use the sort of regional example, have had different strategies, yes, but also more broadly than that, different approaches to risk. If you think about it, you know, there are some countries in Asia which are extremely dependent on tourism. Thailand comes to my mind. And, you know, in some sense, it stands to reason that they are the first who are thinking of opening up. Their Phuket, for example, is now, I think, open to vaccinated travelers, and there are some parts of Bali is thinking of the same. But there's a risk, of course, attached to that. And even within these countries, I think there is some unease about whether it's too soon, about whether it's too quick, whether this is a good idea. I think more broadly, the power of culture in addressing public health concerns, particularly this particular public health concern that we all share, is enormous. But culture also changes slowly. I mean, I think this is one of the things that it can be difficult to change mindsets very quickly. I think there has been a certain sort of path dependency in how some societies. So for example, one point that has been raised is that a lot of the societies in Asia that acted most quickly against the pandemic, including China and Singapore and a few others, they had the experience of SARS. They had the experience over the past 15 or 20 years of other kinds of pandemics, and that this led to certain tools, but also certain fears about how quickly this can spread. And if you look at societies that were very slow to act, a lot of European societies, certainly the United States, it's been a little while since they had a direct experience of this kind of pandemic. There's a certain complacency, perhaps. Certainly in the US, there's been a sort of underfunding of the public health apparatus because of a sense that these problems maybe are not so urgent, they're not so immediate, and that's certainly not been the case in Asia. So I think we've also seen some surprises. I was very surprised at India's sudden lockdown, because the Indian government has tended not to have the power or the capacity to do that. But the idea that this lockdown happened with just a few hours notice, it was one of the most sort of sudden and quickly imposed lockdowns. Even as a historian of India, as someone who's been studying and indeed spending time in India all my life, I found that surprising. I did not see that coming. So I think there are also ways in which there's been some unexpected twists in all of this. So I think it's a great question. I think it's something that we will all be pondering and studying for many, many years to come.
Great, thank you. Great question. Simon had his hand up, so let's have Simon here.
Professor Amrith, nice to see you again. I don't know if you remember me, but
I was do.
Yes. It's very nice to hear you talk about your book to a Chinese audience. I'm just wondering, like, obviously when I was in school and taking your classes, the world was different, right? We were very much marching towards globalization, a very kind of harmonious, globally connected world. And that, I think that kind of ethos kind of impacted academia by kind of interesting more scholars to study kind of cultural interactions and connections between regions in the world. Whereas today we're in a different world almost, and I'm just wondering, like, how much when you are studying a history of connections, how much kind of divisions or identity politics, conflicts were a part of the history of conduction, and also whether, like in the world today, do you feel like the academic research is kind of heading towards another direction of kind of studying difference, studying conflicts, how people develop
animosity great,
towards each other?
Yeah, a great question. Even before this pandemic, after the Trump election, after Brexit in the UK, some historians were very quick to write editorials saying, all of this global history has gone too far. You know, we missed all of this because we were just focusing on connections. You know, we need to study conflict. In some ways, I think, if I think about my own book, for example, Crossing the Bay of Bengal, that is actually, it's as much a story of disconnection as of connection. If I think of this as a sort of plot, I mean, the key plot is that this world falls apart. And in that sense, it's a very familiar story of rising ethnic conflict, rising political tension, borders coming up. If I think about, you know, one of the sort of deep motivations for writing this book, actually some of the worst conflicts in late 20th century Asia, if I think of the Sri Lankan Civil War, and I think of some of the conflicts in Myanmar, they have their roots in precisely this moment of sort of middle of the 20th century and the kind of pulling apart of what had been these very interconnected societies. So, I mean, in my sense, I think we actually, connection and disconnection are two sides of the same coin. Whenever you get these periods of intensive connection, there's always a backlash. I mean, there's so much of our current politics and discourse that is resonant of these earlier moments where, you know, when there is a moment of globalization or opening, of course, that always comes with its enthusiasts. There are those who are very celebratory of it. And then there are those who feel left behind by these kinds of connections, who feel threatened by these connections. If I think about it sort of historically, I feel like that is a pattern that you see repeating itself in different societies. And so in my own view, it's not so much that historians need to, you know, to change direction, but I think they do need to emphasize that whether they're studying connection or disconnection, whether they're studying cosmopolitanism or conflict, that they should always be aware that these are very double-edged, that it's a very sort of two-sided. You know, so to the same extent that I wouldn't want us to become so pessimistic given our current moment where there are so many barriers between people, that we focus sort of exclusively on the histories of conflict and of border making, without realizing that, you know, those moments also pass. Those moments also turn perhaps often to a sort of more open moment afterwards. So I think it's more thinking about it in terms of cycles, thinking about it in terms of you know, the push and pull between the forces of openness and the forces of defensiveness. And I think, you know, it is important, whatever our own views, and if I think about my own view of the world, I tend to be in favor of cultural interaction and very much, you know, hoping to see a world in which there are fewer barriers between people. I think it's important for people like me to understand why many people around the world do feel threatened by that. Do feel frightened by that. And I think history can help us with that. I think history can help us because we have, you know, almost like case studies that we can go to. Like, why is it, or at what moment does what seemed to be a sort of moment of flourishing turn into something different for at least a large part of the population? But thank you for the question.
Yes, thank you, Simon. Great question. Tomahawk asks a question, which I think I can slightly elaborate on. Which is, I was fascinated by your discussion of India and South India and how actually historically it's, you know, that region has always seen itself as part of Southeast Asia until very recently. I think we can make a similar case for places like Guangzhou or Fujian, right? Where actually those regions in China have always been outward looking historically and specifically looking to Southeast Asia. And so Tomahawk's question was, can you elaborate on the Chinese/East Asian immigration history in the region? And I myself also was drawn to that parallel So maybe you could, since we have a primarily Chinese audience, could you talk a little bit more about that?
It really is a parallel in that this is happening at the same time. It's happening under the same historical conditions of sort of transformation. There are some differences though. The first thing is that the Chinese presence in Southeast Asia is broader than the Indian presence, which is to say that Chinese migrants are going to many more places. Indian migrants are tending to stay within the British Empire. They go almost exclusively, they go to Malaya, they go to Burma, Myanmar, they go to Sri Lanka. Chinese migrants are crossing all of these boundaries. They're going to Thailand, they're going to Vietnam, they're going to the Philippines, they're going. So it's a much more broad-based migration that is going, whichever European or other powers are ruling, you have these Chinese migrant networks that are getting there. In terms of the deeper history, I mean, both India and China have these long, long trading connections with Southeast Asia. And that's sort of different kind of history that you can trace back hundreds of years. You know, think about the history of port cities like Malacca. But, you know, there are archaeological remains of Hindu temples in Quanzhou going back 1,000 years. There are signs of Chinese presence in various ports of India, again, going back 1,000 years. So these are sort of, I think of it as a layered history. Like there's a kind of ancient layer of trading connections, mostly merchants, but also Buddhist pilgrimages. You know, there are these religious connections, there are these connections, you know, Fa Xian is traveling all the way from China to India, is crossing the Indian Ocean at a very, very early moment, and others like him. And then you have the kind of mass migration of the 19th century. And that is in response to particularly British domination over the economy of the region. You know, a lot of this is working class migration, not always very free migration. But there too, there's a little bit of a difference in that most Chinese migrants in Southeast Asia, they work for Chinese employers. Whereas most Indian migrants are working for European employers, for white employers. So there's a difference also there. I would say that Chinese migrant society has a little bit more autonomy, partly because the British directly rule India and they also rule Southeast Asia, most of Southeast Asia. So they have much more direct surveillance over Indian migration. That try to control Chinese migration, but basically they can't. I mean, this is one of the very interesting things if you look at the archives of the British, you know, they have their intelligence offices, they have, and they're constantly trying to understand Chinese migrant networks. And usually they throw up their hands and say, we can't, you know, there's too many networks. Whereas with Indian migrants, they have a little bit more of a kind of direct control over who's coming and who's going and how. So these are parallel stories, but I'd say they also have certain social dynamics that are different. There are these institutions in the Chinese diaspora in Southeast Asia, which you don't really find with the Indian diaspora, clan associations, surname associations, all of these ways in which migrant society is to some extent self-governing. I mean, you don't find that so much with Indian migration. Again, partly that's because so much of the Indian migration is going straight to the plantations. And these plantations are, I write about them in this book, they're very controlled spaces. They're very isolated places. They are places where laborers don't have a lot of freedom or autonomy. Chinese labor in Malaysia, to take the example, tended to work in tin mines, which were not, they were smaller. They tended to be in smaller sort of groups with a little bit more autonomy, somewhat more link between the employer and the workers. Often the merchant came from the same town and would bring over workers from there. So there are these connections. Of course, there's also hierarchy, there's also power, but it's a little bit different, I think, with the Chinese migration. But I think the main difference is the geography. The Chinese migration in Southeast Asia is far more evenly distributed, whereas the Indian migration is really limited to primarily British ruled territories. You find very few Indian migrants in Indonesia or in the Philippines, for example, some, but very few.
Very fascinating. And I find your answer actually already covering a lot of the questions that are coming up, which keep those questions coming. These are great questions. And we want to keep this conversation going. David asks, under the colonial invasion of the West, how can colonial countries keep their traditional culture in the forcibly shaped political system after independence?
I mean, that was really the big dilemma that all of the new nations faced. we sort of forget maybe how fundamental the transformation took place in the 1940s, where suddenly, from being an almost entirely imperial space, Asia became a space of free nation states. And these were the questions they asked themselves, like, how can we be genuinely free? So that many of them worried that independence would largely be a fig leaf, like a sort of, we are formally free, but actually nothing will change. In the 1960s, this idea of neocolonialism comes along. The idea that yes, the Western powers seem to have given freedom to these nation states, but they still control their economies. Or in the Cold War, they're still controlling them with foreign aid, American aid in particular. So these are, I think, really live dilemmas. And one of the questions is really that there are different ideas of what the traditional culture is. And I think that is at the heart of many of these conflicts, that the question is, after the colonial invasion by the West, how did these countries keep their traditional culture? I think part of the issue is that they had a lot of disagreements about what the traditional culture was, or which aspects of it to keep and which aspects of it to transform. And that was the root of a lot of problems. So for example, in Southeast Asia, take Malaysia as an example. The question is, well, is only Malay culture traditional culture here? Or is the fact that there are large Indian and Chinese communities, yes, many of them came under the colonial period, but actually they're part of the society. They're also, in a sense, they also come from Asian societies that were under colonial domination. Could we make a new kind of culture that is a more composite culture? And that conflict is still there in Malaysia. And I think most countries in Southeast Asia have this idea that, well, what is the traditional culture? Is it only the culture of one group? Or is the traditional culture actually something that we could piece together from a number of these different currents? And I think almost every country in Southeast Asia, the only country that sort of decides on the other side, which is to say that we have to have a composite culture, is really Singapore. And Singapore decides that, I suppose, for very specific reasons, because Singapore is small, there's not a lot of option to do anything different. Singapore is really the only country in Southeast Asia which explicitly says our culture has to be a composite culture. But Singapore's also a little bit different in that Singapore, when Singapore becomes independent, it doesn't reject the colonial history. Other countries do, but Singapore actually quite proudly sees itself as a successor to Raffles and to the British sort of free trading. So Singapore is, I think, an exception, and in that sense needs to be treated as a sort of slightly different kind of case. Everywhere else in Southeast Asia, you basically have this conflict over what is the culture that we want to preserve and elevate. And Myanmar, of course, so many of the conflicts in Myanmar since the 1940s revolve around that question. The simple question, answer to your very, very important question is that it proved very difficult to do. That in some sense, the legacy of Western domination in this part of the world was very long, long-lived, long-lasting, and has proved difficult to sort of transcend in many ways.
Yes, and something that's still very much at play now. So we're still watching the answer to that question being played out. Qing Zhao has her hand up, as well as the question in the box. So I'm going to ask to unmute you so we can have a good discussion here.
Professor, I just wonder, when you study those cultures in different countries, one barrier you might encounter was to study the documents, but documents may write in different languages. So apart from the language barriers, what kind of challenges you also encounter? And what motivated you to write this book and to finish this book?
Thank you. Language is of course a major barrier, and I suppose language is one reason why the area studies develop in such separate directions, because there's a lot of emphasis in area studies on language training, and that's vital. It remains more important than ever. And I think the difficulty of doing some of this work that's looking across regions is partly language. I could only read one fraction of the languages that were in operation in this part of the world. I always felt, for example, that there was a real weakness in my ability to understand this world because I don't read Chinese. I could read Malay and I could read Tamil and other Indian languages, but I was not able to read the Chinese. And I think to sort of bring these worlds together, you know, that is one reason why I think there's more and more collaborative work that's going on in the humanities. Traditionally, humanities scholars have tended to work alone, unlike scientists, but actually I think that's starting to change, that we realize that there are many more group projects where people have different language skills, they pool their expertise in ways that I think is really meaningful. There are other barriers I certainly faced and now many of my students face when they're doing this kind of work. One is just access to archives. Policies change quite quickly. That 1 year an archive may be open, the next year it may be closed. And this is true right across the region, all the way from India through Southeast and East Asia. So this is like a common dilemma. The other challenge is really, these are very painful histories for some people. Actually, they've left a difficult legacy, and sometimes they continue to have implications in the present day. So sometimes these are histories that people are very careful about how to talk about them. And for me, that was a real dilemma. I thought I want to be as responsible as I can when I write this. You know, you don't want to say things that will heighten current conflicts or to sort of feel like you're being partisan where there are sort of two sides on an issue when it comes to, you know, citizenship questions or border questions. So I did feel like I had to tread carefully, you know, to make sure that I was approaching this as much as a sort of with a little bit of distance and a little bit of detachment and care, because I do think these questions are very live questions, some of them in the region today. And for me, the answer to that was very often, you know, to make sure I was talking very much not only to local scholars, but also to local museum curators, people who are really thinking like, how do you tell these stories? What are the sensitivities? I was motivated to write the book, you know, more than anything else by curiosity. And the more I did this research, the more I became absorbed in trying to understand how this world worked, this world of multiple migrations and languages, et cetera. You know, I was attracted to the idea of doing many different kinds of research. So I used documents, but I also used a lot of oral history, fieldwork, interview-based research. And I found that was itself a sort of motivator. And then in the end, in terms of what motivated me to finish it, I think it was that having spent all of this time hearing these stories, I felt like I needed to tell these stories because I felt they were, you know, certainly they were living with me and they were very powerful in my mind. And I thought, well, actually, these speak to a lot of our current concerns. One of the things that I found most gratifying about this whole process is that, you know, it was published by an American university press. That can make it quite inaccessible in Asia. But what I was very glad about was that, you know, the book, people did respond to it locally in Malaysia, in Singapore. You know, there was enough interest to have it translated in China. I feel like it sort of, that was the greatest reward for me, is that it was, you know, it resonated in some way with the concerns of people in the region as well as scholars outside the region.
Great. I have a feeling we're going to jump back into questions of methodology and things like that later on as well. Leo has his hand raised.
Hello, Professor. Yeah, we know that India was the most important colony of the Great Britain, and a lot of the UK's policies in the 19th and the 20th century was to protect its interest in India, like its policies towards Egypt, its policies towards Palestine and the whole Middle East. So what do you think that these policies affect the migration in the Bay Area? Thank you.
great question. There are so many ways in which the migration within this entire region is really subordinated to the interests of the British Empire. So, I mean, why did they need so much labor to move from India to Malaysia? I mean, it was because Malaysia became so economically valuable to the British Empire. I mean, by the 1920s, 1930s, Malaysia is probably the most economically valuable colony in the entire British Empire because of the rubber, because of the timber, because of the tin. So there are ways in which actually British economic and strategic interests are, they are omnipresent in this story. What is interesting is that their interests start this migration, but then the migration sort of outstrips British interests, which is to say that, you know, migrants are themselves making choices, they're making decisions, they are orienting their lives in particular ways, which may or may not exactly coincide with what the British wanted from them. So for example, you know, the British are increasingly frustrated that they can't control the migration, even from India. By the 1920s, by the 1930s, in the Depression, for example, when suddenly the market for rubber collapses, the British are trying to send people back to India, but many of them don't want to go. Many of them say, well, no, no, this is our home now. And that is a process that the British are not really able to control. And this is something, that's one example of how sometimes these migrations, they take on their own life, even though, you know, to explain how they begin and the interests that they serve to start with, it's entirely to do with just what you've said, which is to say the economic and geopolitical interests that the British have in maintaining India and using India as a sort of base to dominate both Southeast Asia and the Middle East.
Great. So even more interconnected than just, you know, South Asia or Southeast Asia, of course. Valerie has a great question. I'm going to see if Valerie is able to unmute.
Hi, Professor. Thank you so much for being here. And I was, because I'm an international relations major, so my question is more like focusing on international politics. I was just wondering, because I feel like in recent years there has been a very like salient trend in terms of like the integration of the entire Asian Pacific region. And I feel like the boundaries for like the segregation, the geographical segregation that you mentioned, for example, East Asia, Southeast Asia, there has been increasing like challenges on how they're no longer as effective in terms of like understanding geopolitics in the region, but also the relationship between the region and the entire world in a sense. And you see like the formation of ASEAN, you see sort of like the inward economic gravitation. And so I was just wondering, like, do you see these boundaries and segregation fading like in the foreseeable future? Do you think they're still useful, like in terms of like helping us understand the region? Yeah, that was just basically what I was wondering about.
That's great. I agree with you. I mean, I think they are clearly less salient than they were 20 years ago, and are likely to become less so. And you see all of these new ways of imagining Asia. One is this idea of the Indo-Pacific, the Maritime Silk Road, you know, the Belt and Road, of course, is also reorienting. Central Asia is in a different position than, you know, Central Asia used to be treated completely separately, really as a sort of very specialist subfield. And now we see Central Asia is actually crucial to so many of these dynamics of interaction that are going on. I think some parts of Asia are more internally coherent than others. And I think Southeast Asia is actually the best example there. You know, ASEAN is very well integrated. You know, it's probably the best integrated regional grouping alongside the EU. And given the problems that the EU is facing, perhaps it is the most regionally integrated. But ASEAN itself has flexible ideas. You know, China's, of course, increasingly involved with ASEAN. They talk to India all the time as well. So there are ways in which ASEAN is now becoming more than Southeast Asia. And so, yes, at the same time that it preserves that Southeast Asia, it's also pushing beyond it and extending it in important ways. You know, I think there are other ways in which we're thinking about Asia in new ways. I mean, it strikes me that so often the word global is now attached to Asia. I mean, there's a Center for Global Asia at NYU Shanghai. There's a Center for Global Asia at Duke University here, as well as Duke Kunshan. And so there are all sorts of ways in which I think thinking about, as you, you know, the second part of your question, thinking about how Asia relates to the rest of the world is becoming something that people are very interested in. And in the context of doing that, perhaps, you know, those internal divisions seem to matter a little bit less. I do think some of these distinctions can be useful in purely intellectual terms. Going back to the earlier question, you know, some of this is about all languages. Some of this is about understanding that, you know, there are certain cultural or other commonalities that link some parts of the region more than others. But I think the key is really to think of this as a continuum rather than these hard boundaries, which used to really just sort of separate off the study of these different regions of the world.
Great. Let's see if Yifan, if you're able to unmute.
Yes. Namaste, G Professor. Or can I say Wanakam Abgeseho? I'm so happy to see you on screen. I read both of your books in traditional Chinese, the Taiwanese form and Sinhalese Chinese translation, which was published earlier, as well as the English original one. In the past, I've traveled to the countries on the both sides of the Bay of Bengal frequently. I was always so amazed by the cultural links and similarities across the Bay. I'm wondering, could you please elaborate the religious communities' immigrations and the spread out of certain religions, for instance, like Jainism, and the business cultural links across the Bay of Bengal based on that? Thank you so much. Bohot, bohot, danyaba. And Nandri.
Thank you. That's a great question. I've focused a little bit less in what I've been talking about on the merchant communities, but I mean, they are crucial to that broader sort of cultural fabric of the Bay of Bengal. These sort of ancient movements of trading communities. The Jainism, I think, is very important. You also see the importance of Tamil-speaking Muslim merchants going back 500-600 years. Buddhism is very important as a kind of deep cultural link across this part of the world, linking India and China, but also particularly the sort of Theravada Buddhist world. There are very deep links between, you know, Sri Lanka, Thailand, Burma. So there are all these sort of sub-links within this region that I think, and my colleague here, who's curator of the Indo-Pacific collections at the Yale Art Gallery, Ruth Barnes, she has this lovely idea of a sort of family resemblance. So that if you are traveling around the Bay of Bengal, suddenly there'll be a moment of recognizing something. Like the Ramayana story, which of course makes its way into the Wayang Kulit shadow puppet performances in Indonesia. And there's a version of it in Thailand, the Ram Kien. And each one is different. You know, it's not just a transmission, it's a total translation and transformation. But there are these sort of stories, these narratives, which I think people recognize across the region. And they recognize them even across lines of religious difference. So, you know, this is very much part of Indonesian culture, despite the fact that in Indonesia is obviously clearly a sort of Muslim majority society. So there are ways in which I think some of these tales, these religious cultures and others are sort of very important. The Chettiars are very important, the Tamil Chettiars, who are found throughout Southeast Asia and who are very important in building temples, the Mariaman temples that you see across the region. Most of them were constructed by the Chettiar trading community. Sindhi traders are very important. There's a historian called Claude Markovitz who wrote a sort of global history of Sindhi traders. They're all the way from Panama to California, and of course, every single point in East Asia. There are lots and lots of small trading communities around this Bay of Bengal world, some of whom also aren't South Asian. If you think about the Armenians, they play a crucial role. Every single port city from Calcutta to Singapore has an Armenian church. Going back several hundred years, the Armenians are really important trading communities. And of course, they're also linking South and Southeast Asia to Central Asia, into the mountainous parts of Central Asia as well, even into the sort of frontiers of Europe. So there are ways that there are many, many of these communities, and Jane's a great example of one of them, who are Punjabi migrants, of course, again, more in the 19th and 20th century rather than earlier, but they play a very important role. even in Thailand. You know, there's a large Sikh community in Thailand, which arrives there in the 19th century, and you still see traces of this in Bangkok. So I would say that, you know, that's another way to tell this story. You tell this story with all of the small trading communities, all of the movements of religious networks that are in their own way just as important as the large scale movement of laborers or sort of imperial connections that we've talked about.
Fascinating. All right, let's see. We've got time for maybe one last question. Qingda, I'm going to ask you to unmute and you can ask, I guess, both of your questions.
Oh, that's all. Because you mentioned that your study, one area of your study is the environment history. So what's the definition of the environment history?
That is a very good and complicated question. I mean, the broadest definition is that the environmental history is the history of the sort of interaction between human societies and the natural environment, which can work both ways. It can be how the environment shapes human society, and it can also be, of course, about how human beings transform the environment. And in my definition, I think both of those things are interesting. So some of the work I've done on the monsoon, it's more about how the climate actually shapes agriculture and how the pattern of the winds allows for certain kinds of trading connections. But then by the sort of second half of that book of mine called Unruly Waters, it's more about the opposite relationship. It's about how human beings are, you know, fundamentally transforming the environment and even indeed the climate. So I think it's that sort of two-sided relationship that is most useful. Other people think of environmental history, I think, in more geological terms. Like some people think of environmental history as a kind of very long-term history, the kind of history of, you know, evolutionary history over tens of thousands of years. In my own work, it's much more sort of modern environmental history that I do, but there are some colleagues who are sort of thinking on a scale of tens, if not hundreds of thousands of years when they think about environmental history. They're really thinking about the evolutionary history of us as a species. And I mean, this is a field that is as much about, geology and biology as it is about sort of history as we understand it as a sort of modern discipline. So I think it's a real spectrum. We see environmental history, I think, is a very interdisciplinary field. One of the things I find exciting about environmental history is that there's a lot of dialogue between sciences, social sciences, humanities. It's actually a major priority at Yale at the moment, and there's the provost has a big new initiative called the Planetary Solutions Project, which is really trying to bring together the environmental related discussions on this campus across everything from, you know, from systems biology to, you know, even the humanities. And so I feel excited about that as a new way of pooling knowledge, of having conversations across boundaries.
Great, thank you so much. I think that's perfect timing. Thank you for all the wonderful questions, everybody. A fascinating discussion indeed. Very happy to see so many people engaged on these questions. I'm going to unmute everybody so that everybody can thank Professor Amrith personally. So everybody smile. And I'm going to unmute everybody. So thank you, Professor Amrith, for a wonderful discussion.
Thank you all for your wonderful questions, and thank you for coming.
Thank you, Professor.
I hope to visit you all in person at some point. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.